I have thought often about writing another book, and I want to write a book about my experience as a pastor over the last 27 years in performing wedding ceremonies. And I thought about entitling that book, I've Seen It All, because maybe you could add a few more things in there, but when it comes to wedding ceremonies, I'm telling you, strange things happen from our ministers over here. Can I get a witness? I'm telling you, some crazy things happen during weddings. And let me just give you a few little illustrations here. And obviously, all of these come from when I pastored in Mississippi. I have had none of those over the past 15 years here in this place. But I can remember performing a ceremony one time, and really it was the wedding that almost didn't happen. The ceremony was scheduled to begin at 2 o'clock, and it was 20 minutes until 2, and there was no bride. I was getting a little nervous about that time. If you think I was nervous, you should have checked with the groom-to-be. He was really getting nervous. So at 1:45, someone comes in, they say, "Pastor, the bride is here, but I think you really ought to talk to her." So I was led out to the back door of the church, and the bride was out there, and she was just throwing up profusely. Evidently, her nerves had upset her stomach, and she could not stop upchucking. And I remember she said to me, "Now, Pastor, please don't tell mine. I'm not going to mention his name to protect the innocent tonight." But she said, "Please do not tell my fiancé." Now, I did not say this to her, but I wasn't about to tell him. I mean, I was thinking, can you imagine? I get to that part of the ceremony and I say, "You may now kiss your bride." And him saying to me, "You've got to be kidding me." Has she brushed her teeth? I didn't know what kind of response he might come up with. But I finally got her calmed down, and we started about 20 minutes late, but we got the wedding over. I can remember another wedding that happened in the same place, Gulfport, Mississippi. You say, "Man, that's a strange place, isn't it?" Now you know why I came to Panama City. But I can remember this young couple and the groom-to-be, he was a hyper introvert. You think that I'm introverted and I'm bashful, man. I couldn't hold a light to this guy. And I remember in premarital counseling, I told him, I said, "Now, Mike, my wife knows who it is. My kids who are here tonight, they know who it is, Mike and Lisa." I said, "Now, Mike, listen, when you're standing up there, I'm going to lead you. I'm going to direct you. I'm going to tell you everything that you need to know. But don't lock your knees. Because if you do, son, you're going to pass out. I'll guarantee it." But he was so nervous during the ceremony, you could see his tux literally moving like that. He was shaking so badly. Now, I'm not making this stuff up. And when I got to the part of asking the questions that I always do, in which they simply have to reply, "I do." I mean, that's no big deal. He didn't say a word. He just nodded his head. I asked another question. He just nodded his head. And when I got to the part where I actually asked the bride and groom to repeat after me, I deleted that entire section because I knew he wouldn't. When I got finished with the ceremony, I remember the mom of that groom saying to me, "Pastor, I think this is the shortest ceremony I've ever seen." I wanted to say, "I think your son's the weirdest dude I've ever met," but I didn't say that. I remember another ceremony. It was in our first little church, and that church was probably about the size of maybe half of this section right here. It was a real little tiny block church, and it had curtains that were on the windows. And some bright person for that wedding, they put candles on those windowsills. So I'm up here performing the ceremony. I look to my left, and this curtain is just blazing. One of the groomsmen came down off the platform, grabbed a bottle of water, and put out the fire. Now, if you think that's bad, my last crazy story to wrap this up before I give the invitation, my last crazy story is that I actually saw a lady's hair at a reception catch on fire. Remember that, Karen? We were at this reception, and fortunately, it was in the church kitchen, and it was back in the 80s, and she had this frizzed-out hair. Remember those styles? And there was this huge candelabra that was right behind her as she was serving the punch. Now, I don't know if all that gook in her hair was flammable, but I'm telling you, she got too close to that candelabra, and woof, she was lit up. The maid of honor went and got a bowl full of water and just doused her. Looked like the football coach has just won a championship. Man, she looked like a drowned rat. It was the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life. Next Sunday at church, she had this short hairstyle. I'm telling you, I've seen some crazy things happen in wedding ceremonies. Now, with all of that nonsense in mind, tonight as we continue looking at the book of Genesis, I want to talk to us about the first wedding. And I want us to look in Genesis chapter 2, beginning with verse number 18. And these are very familiar verses. I have preached from these verses before, but usually when I have preached from these, I have been in a series on marriage, and I've looked at them more from a topical viewpoint. But tonight, I really want to kind of look into the text and just see what God's Word says about this institution, which, by the way, is under serious attack in our culture today, this institution of marriage. But in Genesis chapter 2 and verse number 18, the Bible says, "And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet fit for him. And out of the ground the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle, and to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs, and he closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and they were not ashamed." Now, three quick truths that we see from these verses. Number one, we see Adam's need in verses 18 through 20. Adam's need. Now, six times so far in the creation story, we have read that joyous refrain, "And God saw that it was good." The seventh refrain that we read was that God saw that it was very good. But here, for the first time in the Bible, do we read of something that is not good. And the Bible says that the Lord God said that it is not good for the man to be alone. Now, in the Hebrew text, this just jumps off the page, because it literally says, "Not good is man's aloneness." Now, when this phrase is used here, that God said it is not good for the man to be alone, that is something far, far more than just an absence of something that is good. But it's the idea of a substantial deficiency. So when God looked at Adam in his aloneness, God said that there is a substantial deficiency about your life. Now, I think there's something that we need to take note of, and that is that the observation and the declaration that it is not good for the man to be alone, that was all of God. That was not of Adam. God's the one who said that. In fact, God did not consult Adam. God was not responding to some complaint by Adam. God just made a statement, a sovereign, unilateral assessment, that it is not good for the man to be alone. As a matter of fact, I don't know if Adam even knew at this point that him being alone was not a good thing. Because after all, where was Adam at this point? Adam was in the garden in Eden. And as he was there in the garden, Adam had everything that anybody possibly could ever want. I mean, everything that would produce a contentment in his heart and in his life, Adam already had that. He had a world full of pets that adored him as their ruler. And yet, Adam, I don't think, had no idea that his condition of being alone at this point was not a good thing. But God said It's not good for the man to be alone. Now, perhaps it's because of the plurality of God that God made that statement. Because God is what? The Godhead. God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I think that at one point in our study in the creation account, we learned that the Godhead has never been alone. There has always been the eternal companions of Father, Son, and Spirit. And so maybe because Adam was created in the very image of God, that image demanded that Adam have companionship, that he should not be alone. But I think the important thing for us to see tonight is that when it comes to this first wedding, the idea of God putting this man and this woman together, this was all God's idea. This was not the idea of some social engineer. This was not the idea that came out of society, but this was an idea that came out of heaven. It was a thought that was in the mind and the heart of God. Now, friend, that is important because as we think about marriage from that perspective, what it tells us is that we ought to have a conviction about the holiness of the institution that we refer to as marriage. It is a holy thing. It is something God has sanctified. God has put His stamp of approval on. God initiated. God thought up. And therefore, when it comes to marriage, you and I ought to think of it as something of tremendous importance. So as we think about Adam's need, there are two things under that, two subpoints I want to make under that. Number one is God's resolve. So Adam has this need, and then God resolves to do something about it. In verse 18, the Lord God said, "It's not good for the man to be alone, so I will make an help meet for him." The word meet there is a word that literally means fit. Now, whatever the reasons for man's aloneness not being good, God's sovereign unilateral resolve was unequivocal. God said, "I will make a help meet fit for him." Now, the word help meet, the word help there literally means helper. So God was saying, "I'm going to make a helper that is fit for him." Now, ladies, don't get offended by that word helper. That word helper is not a diminishing or it's not a servile term. As a matter of fact, did you know that that word helper that was used for the first woman is the same word that is used in Exodus 18, verse number 4, to describe God as the helper of Israel? So obviously that could not be some diminishing or servile term. It is a very important term. Now the function of the helper would be complementary. She would complement the man. She would be fit for him. She would be like him in that she too was created in the image of God and shared in his nature, but she would also be opposite of him because she was called in Hebrew the Isha. She was the woman. Adam was called the Ish. He was the man. Adam was in need, and God declared to Adam, "Help's on the way." And God didn't bring in help by giving him a four-wheel drive or a motorcycle or a new deer rifle, but God gave to him one that would be both like him and unlike him at the same time, one whose differences would make him complete for what God intended for him to do. I think that this is why the Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse number 9 that the man was not made for the woman, but the woman was made for the man. Now, apparently, the woman was more complete than the man. It was the man that was incomplete who needed all of the help. You see, the woman would make it possible for the man to do what he could never do or be alone. In other words, Bubba, you need your wife. And that would be a great place right there for all the ladies to yell out a hearty amen. You see, the differences between the first husband and wife would not serve as a wedge to divide them, but as a supply for what each of them were lacking. God made us different so that we might be able to function as one. It is our differences that bring us together. In other words, what I say to us tonight, husbands and wives, is capitalize on your differences rather than living conflicted over your differences. You know, guys and gals are not going to think alike. Get used to it, accept it. That's just the way that it is. A woman's mind is in her heart. A man's mind is in his head, if he has one. Occasionally, if you stumble across a guy that's got a mind, it's going to be in his head. And you know, the interesting thing is that these two radical differences can complement one another when both of those individuals whose minds are in different places, physiologically or biologically, if both of those people are living underneath the lordship of Jesus Christ. And guys, I would say to us tonight that sometimes we need to think with our hearts. Sometimes in the family, we need to think with our hearts. And gals, sometimes in the family, we need to think with our minds. So both of these are necessary, or God wouldn't have made us like that. Just yesterday, it's amazing to me how God brings things up in my personal life that give me great sermon illustrations. But I was looking for something that I had placed on my desk in the bedroom. Now, when I put something down, I know where it is. I know exactly where I place it, and I place it there in order for it to be left there. And so I went to retrieve what I had left, and guess what? It's not there. And so I walked into the kitchen, and I said, "Karen, have you seen this item?" She said, "Yes, it's on your desk." I said, "No, it's not. I just left the bedroom. I looked. It's not there." She said, "Craig, did you look past your nose?" It's one of her favorite sayings. And I said, "Yes, dear, I looked past my nose." She said, "Follow me." We walked into the bedroom. She moved a stack of junk, and there was what I was looking for right in the midst of that stack. "Why did you move it?" And she said to me, "Craig, you need to learn to think like a woman." "I don't want to think like a woman. That's why I married you, so you can think like a woman. We got enough woman thinking around my house to go around Bay County. I don't need to think like a woman. And I better get off of that if I want to be able to go home and spend the night with a woman." And so we see God's resolve, and then we see Adam's awareness. Now, I told you that at this point that I don't think that Adam was aware that being alone was not a good thing. So he was not even aware that something was missing in his life. And so I think that God prepared him by sending him through this awareness program. And that awareness program, it's amazing how God's got to have a sense of humor. Because it says that in verse number 19, that out of the ground that the Lord God formed every beast of the field, every fowl of the air, he brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. Now, what's interesting is that up to this point, everything in creation, the sovereign God of the universe has named it. But now, with all of these animals, God says, I'm making you sovereign over the animal kingdom, so I want you to name all of these animals. Have you ever tried to figure out how he did that? You're talking about a monumental task. How did he do that? How did he come up with all of those different names? I mean, was Adam some kind of a Dr. Doolittle on methamphetamines? I mean, how in the world did he accomplish such a feat? Friend, I don't know how he did that. You don't know how he did that. It's all conjecture on our parts. But there is one thing I am sure of. I am sure that Adam was aware of the social relationship and companionship of these animals that marched by him two by two. And he said, "Uh-oh, I don't have one of those. And I need one of those." And that was simply God's way of preparing Adam to receive the wife that he was about to give unto him. And so we see Adam's need, but secondly, in verses 21 through 23, we see God's supply. And as we look at God's supply, there are two things we take note of. Number one is that the woman was created. In verse 21, it says, "And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam." He slept. And so the Lord took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man made he a woman, and he brought her unto the man. So woman was created. The Bible says that Adam was put into this deep sleep. Have you ever noticed how many times in the Bible that there is this divinely induced sleep that God gives to people? Think about Abraham. Remember when God made that covenant with Abraham? And he had to pass through those two parts. And the Bible says that God put him to sleep before he did that. And God did that because obviously that Abrahamic covenant was an unconditional covenant, and he wanted Abraham to understand he didn't have anything to do with that. I think that when Jonah fell asleep in the bottom of that boat, that was a divinely induced sleep. It's almost like the idea that man does not have the capability of being able to look upon the creative work of God. You know, man can look at the creative works of God and revere them, but man does not have the ability or capability to look upon the very act of the creation of God itself. Maybe that's why God put him to sleep, but God put him to sleep and then performed divine surgery, as it says that the Lord took one of his ribs. And there are a whole lot of commentators who say that the word rib here is actually used as a metaphor. I don't think so. I think this was an actual rib, and I think that because of theological reasons that I will point out to you in just a moment. But I don't think that it was used metaphorically at all. I think God opened him up, and God actually literally took out one of Adam's ribs, and he made the woman out of that rib. There are other commentators who say that God made the woman from Adam's side. But to me, that makes no sense because the Bible says God took one of his ribs. I mean, it's ludicrous to say that God took one of his sides. No, God took one of his ribs. Now, that does not mean that men have one less rib than women today. When God closed up Adam from that surgery, he had one less rib. But those of us today who are the children of Adam, we can count them all. We all have equal ribs, don't we? But what is the deal? What is the important thing about this being an actual and a literal rib that God used for the creation of Eve? I think that theologically that it means two things. It means number one, that they had a shared image. You know, when God created Adam, he did not create him ex nihilo, that is out of nothing. He created him from the dust of the ground, right? And when God created Eve, he did not create her ex nihilo, but he created her from the rib that he had taken from the man. In other words, Eve was made from the same stuff Adam was. She had the same bone, the same flesh, the same DNA, because she too was created in the image of God. We know that because in Genesis 1 verse 27, it says, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them." So the theological import says that because she was made from the rib of Adam, and she too was created in the very image of God. And so when Adam reached out and he embraced his lovely wife for the first time, he was literally embracing that which was a part of himself. So it speaks of the shared image, but it also speaks, I think, of a shared equality. It was the great Puritan commentator and preacher, Matthew Henry, who said, and you've heard this, I'm sure, 100 times, that God did not make the woman out of man's mind so he could rule over her, nor out of his feet to be trampled upon by him, but out of his side to be equal with him, under his arm to be protected by him, and near his heart to be loved by him. The whole idea of a shared equality. In other words, God made them in the same image, and yet, listen, that was two becoming one, and yet they were different because one was a woman, one was a man. And friend, there are differences between the males and the females. And it's sickening to me to live in a culture that tries to make men out of women and women out of men. God made them different. And he gave them different roles and different functions in society and in life. So this shared equality. And I love verse 22 that says that the rib which the Lord God had taken from the man made he a woman, And then God brought her to the man. It's almost like the picture of here's a father and he is escorting his lovely daughter down the aisle to give her away to that groom-to-be. So here comes the Lord God and he gives Eve to Adam. And he says, this is my gift to you. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing, a marvelous thing, if all of us who are married would receive our mates as gifts from God? Wouldn't we treat one another more kindly, more graciously? We would not reject one another, because in doing so, we would know that we were rejecting that which was the very gift of God. You see, that's the way that God, I think, wants us to view marriage. So the woman was created, and then secondly, Adam responds. And he responds in verse number 23. I mean, his mind has already been set up for what God's about to make him. And you have to realize that when God brought Eve to Adam, she was perfect. Perfect in soul, perfect in body. This is the only perfect 10 there has ever been. And Adam looked at her and said, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Adam said, wow, this is what I have been waiting for. Thank you, Lord God, she's much better than that zebra that just passed my way. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful, amazing gift. But I think that there's something very important in this response. When he says in verse number 23 that this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. You know what that speaks about? That speaks about the radical intimacy of marriage. Could anything be more intimate than bone of bone and flesh of flesh? Adam and Eve initially had such an amazing intimacy between the two of them. And men and women, can I tell you, God's plan has not changed? God still plans for there to be intimacy within the marriage relationship. And if I don't have that in my marriage and you don't have that in your marriage, it's not God's fault, because that is God's plan. And you know, when it comes to this idea of intimacy, it's the guys who always need to sit up, open up their ears and listen. Because it's the men in the area of intimacy who are always the duds. It's always the men. I can prove that to you. Men, let me ask you, how many books have you read on intimacy? Point made. How many books do you have in your library on intimacy? Men, how many articles have you read on intimacy? Listen, I'm for you tonight. How many paragraphs have you read on intimacy? Have you even read a sentence on intimacy? What do the women read? Articles on how to develop intimacy in your marriage. What do we read? How to double your gas mileage. We are such intimate, romantic duds, aren't we? And yet God says, I want there to be intimacy in your marriage. And since we are a tripart being, what that means is that God wants us to be intimate in all of those areas of our makeup. He wants there to be physical intimacy. Now, friend, that's where it starts, you know, because when we are attracted one to another as husband and wife, what is the first thing that attracts us? Now, don't you tell me that you were attracted to your husband or your wife because of their mind. That you could have cared less about their mind. We are attracted physically, aren't we? I have never met anybody who told me, man, I was so attracted to them because they were just so ugly. I could not wait to marry them. I mean, they were so ugly, they would make a train take a dirt road, and that is what attracted me to that person. No, that's not it at all. We are physically attracted. That's where it all starts. God wants us to have physical intimacy in our marriage based on attraction, and yet we better have more than that. Because, you see, we enter into that stage of life where that physical attraction goes south. And friend, I want to tell you, if all you've got is physical intimacy, at that time, when that attraction goes south, you're out of business. So you better have something going for you other than that. But let me just stop there and parenthetically say, I don't have this in my notes, but I just feel led of the Lord to bring this out tonight. You know, we ought to do all that we can not to enter into that area prematurely. You know, we ought to keep up that attraction stage as long as we can. Now, some of you are like me, you don't have much to work with, but you can do the best with what God's given you, you know? Now, guys, listen, I don't want you to shoot me tonight or run me out of the building. But we could work on this. There is nothing sexy about a spare tire hanging around your middle. Nothing at all that makes your life look at you and say, boy, I'm attracted to that person. Guys, listen. You can shave sometime between Christmas and Easter. In fact, it wouldn't hurt you to shave every day. Put on a little cologne, a little aftershave. That won't hurt you. Fix yourself up for your mate. Make yourself attractive to them. And they won't start looking around for attraction in somebody else. Now you say, preacher, what you're talking about is none of your business in my life. I'm trying to help you. If you've got sense enough to listen to me tonight. Listen, this is practical stuff and it'll work. Some of you men wonder why it is that your wife hadn't had a desire to kiss you in the last 10 years. And yet you shave about once a month. When's the last time you tried kissing a porcupine? You know, every time she rubs up against you, she looks like she's been drugged through a briar patch. She doesn't want to spend any time hugging your neck. Guys, listen, you're just lazy. Lazy. And it doesn't even hurt to shave on Saturday. Fix yourself up and be attractive on Saturday for your mate. And wives, I want to tell you what, walking around the house with those old dingy sweatpants that was handed down to you by your great-great-great-great-grandmother. You say, oh, man, I'm saving money. I'd rather you spend some. That's not attractive. I read the other day about a church down in South Florida somewhere that was going to have what they called a book burning, in which they were going to get a bunch of these books together, these ungodly books, and they would have a book burning at their church. And as I was thinking about this sermon, I said, probably a lot of ladies need to have a bathrobe burning, you know? What I'm trying to say is God would have us to fix ourselves up for one another. The most important person in my life is this lady sitting right here. And I want her to have eyes for me and nobody else. And I want to be attractive to her. And you know, guys and gals, that's the way we ought to feel about one another. Can I get a witness? So there is this physical intimacy. There's also soul intimacy. And we know what dwells in the soul. That's the mind, that's the emotions, that's the will. And to get these three things together, what do we have to do? We have to communicate. We have to talk with one another. And once again, guys, I'm sorry, but we are the ones who need the help in this area when it comes to communicating with our spouses. Let me tell you something, guys. When you come to your wife and she asks you a question, never is she looking for a one-word answer. When you come home in the afternoon from work and your wife says, how did your day go, dear? She is not looking for you to respond with one word, fine. She wants details about your day. That's how she shares her life with you and how you share your life with her. All ladies are detail-oriented. I can talk to Karen's dad on the phone for 30 minutes, and she says, how is Dad doing? And I say, he's fine. She don't want to hear that. She wants details because women remember details. Men, can I get a witness there? You could ask my wife tonight about our wedding day. She could give you every detail about the day we got married. She could tell you what everybody wore. She could tell you about the music that was sung. She could tell you about the food that we ate at the reception. All I can remember is that I had one. We're not detailed guys. But God says, I want you to be intimate in your soul, that part of you that communicates. And so, guys, listen, if we're going to love our wives like Christ loved the church, then we've got to work at that. Now, I know some of you are a lot more spiritual than me, and you need absolutely no help right there. I could get your wife off in the corner and ask her to tell me the truth under God. She would say he's a liar. He needs a lot of help in that area. So there's physical intimacy, there's soul intimacy, there's spiritual intimacy. And by the way, that's the most important one. When we get together on the spiritual level, what does that mean? That means that both husband and wife are saved. Saved. God's plan has never been for a believer to marry an unbeliever. I'm telling you, God's plan is for marriage to be between a husband and wife where both of them are saved, where both of them are surrendered to the lordship of Jesus Christ. To be intimate spiritually means that, listen, it means that we go to church together, that we read the Bible together, that we pray together, that we discuss spiritual things together. I want to tell you what, a marriage where there is spirit intimacy, there are not enough demons in hell to break up a marriage like that, where both husband and wife are surrendered to the lordship of Jesus Christ. So we see Adam's need, we see God's supply. Last of all, very quickly, we see marriage ordained in verses 24 and 25. And there are two things that God said when he ordained marriage. Two words I want to mention very quickly. The first word is the word leave. The word leave. Verse 24, therefore shall a man leave his mother and his father. What does that mean? That means that when we get married, that there is a new priority when it comes to relationship. And that new priority is the priority of a husband and wife, not the priority of a son or a daughter. Friend, what God says is that we've got to cut the apron strings, but we can cut the apron strings without severing the heart cord. It does not mean that we abandon our parents. It does not mean that we forsake our parents. It does not mean that we do not listen to our parents. It means that the priority relationship from that point forward is between husband and wife, not son and daughter and mother and father. That's the new relationship. We have to leave mother and father. And let me say something to those of us who have married children. Sometimes we prohibit them from leaving us. Sometimes we're a big part of the problem. Sometimes we just interfere. We won't stay out of their way. We're always giving unsolicited advice. Now listen, young couples, wise are you if you will seek the counsel and the advice of parents who have walked where you hadn't been. Wise are you if you will do that? But God would have us as parents of married children not to always be giving advice unless it is asked for. And I think I've shared this with you before, but some of the best advice that I could give moms and dads with married children is simply this. Hands off, hearts open, prayers on, mouths closed. Hands off, hearts open, prayers on, mouths closed. And when we do that, we allow them to obey this and leave father and mother. And then the second word is the word cleave. He says cleave, and the word literally means to stick to. Stick to your wife, stick to your husband as one flesh. And you know exactly what that is talking about, right? That is talking about the permanency of marriage. You know, no one should ever enter into a marriage with the idea of a back door. No one should ever enter into a marriage with the D word being used in their vocabulary. Now, friends, some of you are here tonight and you have been divorced. And I want to say something to you. You have been divorced and you were a victim of divorce. You didn't want it. You stood against it. You fought against it. You did everything you could not to be divorced. But you were married to somebody who had their mind made up to rebel against the Word of God. I'm telling you, don't you walk around this place loaded down with guilt. That was not your fault. But if I'm speaking to you tonight and you're the one that caused a divorce, then you need to seek the forgiveness of the Lord and you need to repent. Because God is serious. I'm telling you, God is serious about the institution of marriage. And how does God define marriage? We hear so many people tell us today what marriage is. God says marriage is a monogamous heterosexual relationship. And anything other than that is a perversion. Did you hear me? Anything other than that is a perversion. And presidents and legislators who legitimize same-sex marriages, they are rebelling against a creation ordinance and they are reproaching the very name of God Almighty Himself who instituted it. And God will not be mocked. And I for one am tired of hearing presidents and politicians saying, "I am a Christian," and yet at the same time stand in opposition to God's very first institution, which is the family. I'm telling you, God will not be mocked. I don't know about you, but when I watched the inaugural speech of our president, my heart was so broken as he went on and on and on and on and on about the legitimacy of same-sex marriages and said nothing about a $16 trillion debt. That told me that here is a guy in office that doesn't have the wisdom to be there. I know that I'm meddling. I know that this is political, but I'm here as one to tell you I will not bow down to the cultural belief that this is okay. It's not okay. It's a sin against the living God, and the Church of Jesus Christ must stand up for the sanctity of marriage. Because once that's gone, friend, I don't know much else what we have left. Do you? God says marriage is for a man and a woman for a lifetime. I don't know how to give an invitation after all that, but would you stand? Would you stand with our heads bowed and eyes closed? And I don't know, maybe you're here tonight and you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus. I want to tell you, you can't have the kind of marriage God desires you to have if you do not have Jesus Christ sitting on the throne of your heart. You're here tonight and maybe you just need to pray for your marriage. Maybe just a husband and a wife need to take one another by the hand, come to the altar. Maybe a husband just needs to say, "Dear, I'm sorry I've not been the spiritual leader in our family, and I want to start over tonight." I'll guarantee you that godly wife will stand with you and stand behind you to do that. But if God's spoken to your heart, you need a church home tonight, we would invite you to come. But Father, thank you that so many of us here tonight have been blessed with a godly marriage. I pray for those who are here tonight, oh God, that divorce has hit their home. God, I pray that they would not leave this building in any way feeling condemned. God, I pray that your sweet grace would be sufficient for them. For those, Lord, who have been victims of a situation like this, may God, you encourage their hearts as they try to do the right thing. Let them know that you know that. You know that. God, I pray for them. I pray for all of our families and homes and marriages here that make up the First Baptist Church. God, that they would be the best they can be for the glory of God. And I pray it in Jesus' name.